Friends,
we are very happy to inform you that e-modules are prepared for B.Ed program at Telangana by the School of Education, Usmania University, under Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya National Mission on Teachers and Teaching Scheme, MHRD, New Delhi. It's indeed our pleasure to share with the teacher educators and the prospective teachers and get maximum benefit out of it. It's a first of its attempt by us. We continue to add many more such lessons to share with you all.
Hello everyone, namaste. Myself Dr. Krishna Reddy Chittredi, Assistant Professor, School of Economics, University of Hyderabad. Today we are going to discuss on privatization, liberalization and Indian education. From this module, what are the expected learning outcomes? Identifying and characterizing the key issues of privatization, liberalization and Indian education, and assessing the impact of privatization and liberalization on Indian education sector and the economy, and exploring the advantages and the disadvantages of the privatization and liberalization of education, right? So due course of this time, we expect to learn from these the three major outcomes. Universally, education is regarded as an important investment in human resource growth. This is the gateway to technological growth and economic development. The government's primary goal is to provide education to all citizens. The central and the state governments financed much of higher education until the beginning of the 90s. In the 1990s, the government of India has been implemented the LPG model, that is liberalization, privatization and the globalization. And these policies allows a significant changes of earlier government restrictions, that's known as a liberalization, and participation of a private entities in business and services, that is a privatization, and integration of a national economies with the other economies of the world. This is known as a globalization. Now, if you look at the total number of universities and colleges in India, reached 39,050 and 903 in 2017-18 respectively. In 2017-18, India had 36.64 million students enrolled in higher education. The higher education gross enrollment ratio reached 25.8% in 2017-18. The India is the second largest e-learning market after the United States. And by 2021, with about 9.5 million users, the sector is projected to hit $1.96 billion. Maybe with this COVID-19, it may we reach more than what was projected also. So education is one of the basic necessities expected in modern state for its citizens. It is service which every welfare democracy has to deliver in the most open manner. Simply put, education privatizations refers to the state policy of allowing higher and lower educational institutions to be operated for monetary gain by non-state or private parties. If you look at the Indian history on the education, which is very ancient and which is very popular across the globe, India has been considered as a temple of learning. Several foreign travelers came to India for higher education, and others wrote information about the love of knowledge among the Indians. Around first to 28th century of AD, renowned colleges in ancient India existed. Popular centers of higher learning in India have been Nalanda, Takshashila, Vallabhi, Vikramashila and Kanchipuram. So, these are the very popular centers which has created many stalwarts and scientists which has given to the world. Now, then what is this education of privatization? The concept of privatization is an umbrella term for many specific educational services and policies. An overall definition which was given by Levin 2001, the privatization is the transfer of activities, assets and the responsibilities from the government or the public institutions and organizations to private individuals and agencies. In addition, privatization is also seen as liberalization, where agents are freed from state controls or commercialization, where new markets are developed as alternatives to government programs or state allocation schemes. And if you look at what are the factors driving the privatization in education, across the globe, the demand for higher education has risen extremely rapidly, and India is not an exception to this trend. There are several factors in education that drive privatization. The strength of these factors differs among countries and in three sectors of primary, secondary and tertiary education. Over the years, the government has argued that there is immense limit on capital. So, these promoted the government to opt out of the field of higher education. While the emphasis on primary education is on growing reliance on private initiatives. Not only is the government voicing its unwillingness to raise higher education spending, but the current state supported institutions are also facing very bleak future. The unwillingness of public higher education institutions to cope with these limitations has been forced to deliver a significant number of self-funded courses. The growing demand and inability of conventional universities to keep up with that demand has significantly encouraged that entry of the private sector. Most parents choose to place their children in private schools that provide a higher standard of an education than the government schools. These are prepared to pay much greater fees so that the children can benefit from the world-class schooling with global standards and facilities. If you look at, then what are the roles of the governments, right? So, we have seen what is the trend which is happening. Now, let us understand the role of the governments. After 1949, there was a compulsory and the responsibility of the state government to provide a higher education. The institutions providing education were public in character. However, significantly increase in higher education universities, colleges and institutions, while also increase in unsupportable financial burden to the state government. Moreover, the state government did not have the option to allow private companies to start the universities and institutes. The liberalization, privatization and the globalization of reforms has significantly encouraged the privatization as a result of various category of education providers. The LPG process has given boost to this process. As result, different categories of education providers emerged. India's education sectors remain a key policy priority. The Indian government has given 2400 billion dollars worth of cumulative FDIs in the education sector since 2002 via an automated route to the government of India. Indian education sector witnessed 18 merger and acquisition deals, which is worth of 342.4 crores in 2017 year. India has signed a loan agreement with the World Bank under the project Skill Acquisition and Knowledge Awareness for Livelihood Promotion to strengthen the institution's skills growth mechanisms. Prime Minister Honorable Narendra Modi launched a Skill India initiative, Kaushal Bharat, Kushal Bharat. Under this initiative, the government has set itself a target of training 400 million citizens by 2022 that would enable them to find the jobs. Because in India, as on today, less than 5% of the population are skilled with necessary for to employ them into the formal sector, formal or informal sector. So that shows the negligence of the, since independence to now, the governments has relatively neglected to train the youth of these nations. And the Honorable Prime Minister now, he has taken with a great mission to achieve, to train the youth of these nations where they can provide better services to the nation. The initiatives launched include various programs like Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, National Policy for Skill Development and Entrepreneurship 2015, Skill Loan Scheme, and the National Skill Development Mission. In December 2018, the Government of India published that 3.43 million candidates had enrolled in the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, PMKVY 2016-20 scheme. Up to January 24, 2019, as many as 2.53 million candidates were trained under the scheme's short-term training. The government allowed the private sector to set up a self-finance and fee-paying institutions that could meet the increasing demand for higher education for different courses. This refers to shift in the position of the government. The government was both the higher education provider and the regulator. The recommendations of different policy documents in the post-economic reform period clearly shows the effect on higher education in our country of neoliberal ideology. Most reform proposals proposed two-way higher education strategies, enhancing performance in the functioning of the public institution on the one hand, and mobilizing support from non-governmental sources on the other. The main objective of the reform initiatives is to improve the degree of productivity in the utilization of capital so that there is no need to allocate additional resources to the sector. The reform initiatives help to identify potential funding opportunities or include other alternatives for higher education funding. If you look at the paradigm shift in the education, it was prioritized national education, now it has become a global education, and one time education was the slogan, now it is a lifelong education, and education was limited groups, now education for all. The government used to control, now you would see that markets are controllers, and the based on the social demand which was there, education, now based on the economic demand which was shown, and education was as a merit good, now education is a market good. So this is a paradigm shift in education before and after the liberalization. And how it has impacted on, you know, this liberalization on Indian education system in India. The efficient and well developed higher education system can promote finest quality in the field of research as well as improves a teaching ability. As a result, it provides a central for an emerging knowledge economy. Therefore, the government is responsible for providing higher education accessible to all as per constitutional rights. But Indian higher education system is always facing several challenges. The challenges of global competitiveness have been added to the other demanding tasks such as equity, quality, and access to all in the face of resource crunch. To overcome these problems, our Indian government has restored to privatization of higher education system. The privatization of higher education system has a potential to improve the quality of education as well as the other relative factors. But let's try to understand what are the advantage and the disadvantages with this kind of a privatization country like in India, because the still significant of the population who are living in the below poverty line and not able to meet their basic, you know, requirement to fulfill their livelihood. So given that kind of an a scenario, how far that, you know, the privatization of an education would benefit the country? So we try to look at those and advantages, disadvantages also. Liberalization allowed the supply and the competition among educational institutions. It resulted with global quality and minimum cost for pursuing in a higher education. Because of the competition between these educational institutions, the relatively the cost of a quality higher education has declined. This we could see one of the positive aspect. The other would be privatization of education has increased opportunities by increasing the scope of enrollment ratio to all levels of education. Now since there is a private entry, people has entered, and the availability to their native places of accessing education has increased. So due to the ownership, the level of quality increased, the level of quality increased to a large extent in few steps. However, this is not true for all private organizations, right? It is not necessary to believe that all the private organizations are in the quality terms. There are many public funded institutions which are any very quality, like our IIMs, Indian Institute of Management and Institute of Technologies, and our even Indian universities like Jawaharlal Nehru University, University of Hyderabad, like BHU. So we have several other institutions which are ranked in the world also. public funded institutions. So due to the liberalization, the higher educational institutions in India have been able to obtain ranking as per the global QS rankings, which is one of the prestigious rankings which universities takes. The Indian economy, which is largely fueled by the service industry, will be boosted by the fact that the education sector is becoming a large part of the economic source. Liberalization gives students an opportunity to study near home with the added advantages of a degree that will be applicable in the world. It is also curbs the brain drain that loses the loss of a country too, because we are seeing many of the Indian citizens migrates to the developed countries and study and continue to work and contribute to the foreign economies rather than to the domestic economies. So once these institutions of the world repute, if they establish here, the students can learn the quality education and also can serve to the own nation to that. Allowing companies to cultivate a better industry oriented students with different skill sets will ensure that. So that what industry and academia collaboration can take place, and the people who are graduated, based on that they would easily to get the employment on their professions. Rising in educated population means the rapid technical and communicational changes. This is also means that society is moving from industrialization to on information based culture. So all this we can look at in a positive sense of how the liberalization has contributing to the human resources of this any nation. Now what are the negative impacts of liberalization on education system, particularly to India? Quality of opportunity requires affirmative action. It is an intervention that allows the poor to contend with others with fairness and integrity. For educational institutions, reservation is an affirmative action. It allows poor communities to people to get education to compete with a privileged classes. But the corruption is rampant in India, so there is a little left to imagination as to what might be the outcome of a such policy in terms of bribes, false degrees, partial marking, etc. There may be unforeseen outcomes which come to the light only after the outcome occurs. The local institutes with the small resources may not able to survive, leaving many unemployed. There is a scope for it. Even the reputable ones will face a competition as their national certificates will be less valued than world renowned certificates. In developing countries, uninformed or simply doubtful institutions can form a partnerships with colleges and universities of low quality. In India, there is also the possibility that fake institutes may try to fill their pockets whenever the opportunity rises. In whole sum, if you look at this, privatization of education is a global phenomena, and existing data indicate a worldwide trend to privatize education, such as provision and funding as a major educational measure. Privatization must be controlled democratically, be tamped so that traditional aim of community building education is safeguarded and social cohesion and solitary work is achieved. It is believed that the public sector will draw attention to the issues of public interest, stewardship and unity, while the private sector will offer access to capital, technological expertise, managerial performance and entrepreneurial spirit. And it is assumed that the public sector can collaborate productively with market and mitigate its surpluses by ensuring that equal rights concerns are taken into account, including the need to prevent discrimination and exploitation, guarantee continuity and stability for services and foster social cohesion. Overall, an increase in educational quality may be accomplished by cooperative relationship between the public and private sectors. So, this lesson will help us to understand the, you know, basically with how this privatization has, you know, impacting, changing. Because given a change in the global economies, it has become inevitable, and we also emphasize that the public sectors and the private sector may need to go into hand in hand or in the public private partnership to meet the national interest and the global needs, so that the human resources will strengthen and will give us the an expected positive outcome for a country like in India, where we have the higher degree of, you know, heterogeneity in the socially, economically, in the the diversity, and hope that this private sector, which will be only complementing to the public sector funding institutions rather than killing those public funded institutions. So I hope you learned from this module on the privatization and liberalization education of India. Thank you.